In this video, we want to think about the process of swallowing, or deglutition. Deglutition is just a sort of medicalized physiological name for swallowing. But this is a process actually in three main stages. Now, the first stage is voluntary, and that is the oral stage in the mouth. We control that. The second stage is the pharyngeal stage, and that is autonomic. It's controlled automatically by the autonomic nervous system. And the third stage, the esophageal stage, where the food goes from the pharynx down into the stomach, is also autonomic, controlled by the autonomic nervous system. Now, it's quite a complicated process in a lot of ways, so let's try and draw a diagram to try and get to grips with some of the basic anatomy. And then we can work out how this anatomy is functioning in a coordinated way to give rise to this very controlled physiological process. And you'll have to draw a diagram with me. So let's think about the, here we have a nose. And then there's a gap for the mouth. And of course there's the neck beneath that. So that's my diagram of this anatomy. Now, if you run your tongue along the roof of your mouth, it's kind of dome-shaped and it's hard. So you have the roof of the mouth here. That's the roof of the mouth. And the reason it's dome-shaped and hard is you have a bone along here, and that is your hard palate. It's called the hard palate because obviously it feels hard. So underneath the tissues, along the roof of the mouth, is this bone, the hard palate. But then if you look in the mirror, you can see that dangly bit at the back of your mouth. That's the uvula. And there's also some other tissues there, and these comprise the soft palate. So there we have the hard palate, and then we have the soft palate, which is like a flappy bit there at the back. And this goes round, and then, of course, above your mouth, you've got very extensive nasal passages. So here we have the nasal passages. And then this comes back down, something like this. Now, along the base of your mouth, of course, you've got your tongue. So the tongue's going to be in this area here. And then this goes down, and of course you've got that lumpy bit in your throat, which is your larynx. So that's going to be... The larynx and the trachea are actually very superficial near the front of the neck. So the larynx is going to be here. Now the larynx is that hard cartilaginous box, and of course that contains your vocal cords to generate speech. And the larynx, of course, is continuous with the trachea with its rings of cartilage here. And immediately behind that, behind the larynx and the trachea, is the esophagus, the food pipe. Now, actually in life, the esophagus is fairly closed. It'll just open up when a bolus goes through it. It's a muscular tube. And also, the top of the airway here, at the top of the larynx, if you looked at that from on top of the waves, you would see it was like a hole in the top of the airway. And that hole in the top of the airway is called the glottis. And the glottis is protected by the overlying epiglottis. So here we have the epiglottis here. And of course, most of the time, when you're breathing anyway, the epiglottis has got to be raised so the air can get in and out, because this opening to the airway here, the glottis, is the only way air is going to get in and out of the lungs. So what we see really is we have some soft, flexible parts, like your tongue is clearly soft and flexible. There's actually a great deal of the motor cortex dedicated to controlling the tongue. We have a vast range of movements in the tongue. And The hard palate, of course, is rigid. That's the bony part. But at the back, we have the soft palate, and that is also flexible. So the soft palate is flexible and continuous with the hard palate. And the epiglottis, covering the glottis, is actually made largely of cartilage, but again, that can flap up and it can flap down. So let's think about the first stage that's going on. Food goes into the mouth, and then the process there is chewing, or the process of mastication. So we chew the food, and what's happening there is the sides of your mouth are pushing the food in between your teeth. And very occasionally, of course, that goes wrong, doesn't it? And you bite the side of your mouth and it hurts. And your tongue is also controlling the food in your mouth. And of course, occasionally that goes wrong and you bite your tongue when you're chewing. Very painful. So the sides of the mouth and the tongue are controlling the food, placing it between the upper and lower teeth so it can be crushed between the teeth. It can be masticated. And at the same time, it's mixed with saliva. And one of the components of saliva is mucus. So it becomes moistened. And during this process, what happens is the tongue and the cheeks and the teeth, all working together, form the ball of food into a bolus, a single collection of food, a bolus. And then what happens to swallow is your tongue, starting at the front, it presses the bolus of food against the hard palate. So there's your hard palate there, and your tongue presses it sequentially back the way like that. So your tongue is pressing it back along your hard palate. And as we see behind the mouth here, this area is the pharynx. So this is the larynx, this is the pharynx. So what we have here is we have the nasal passages. Behind the nasal passages, we have the nasopharynx. Behind the mouth, we have the oropharynx. And level with the larynx, we have the laryngopharynx. So nasopharynx, oropharynx, laryngopharynx. So the tongue forms this bolus of food, and then the tongue rises and pushes the bolus of food back the way like that. And that bolus of food goes through there into the oropharynx at the back. Now that stage of swallowing, when the mouth pushes the bolus of food from the oral cavity into the oropharynx, that is voluntary. But after that, the process becomes autonomic, controlled by the autonomic nervous system. So the sensory nerves located in the wall of the oropharynx just here. For example, there's branches of the 9th and 10th cranial nerve. You might remember the 9th cranial nerve is the glossopharyngeal, and the 10th is the famous vagus nerve. So once the bolus of food goes into the oropharynx, messages from there go up towards the medulla oblongata of the brainstem. And in the medulla oblongata of the brainstem, there is the swallowing centre, or the deglutition centre, that controls this process. So we now have a bolus of food here. Now the next thing that needs to happen is the food needs to go from here down through the pharynx and into the top of the esophagus just there. But in the way, we don't want the food to come back out of the mouth. That would be unpleasant. And we certainly don't want the food to go into the nasal cavities. Maybe after you've vomited or been sick, you kind of get bits of food stuck in your nose, and it just feels horrible, doesn't it? So we don't want the food to go back that way. We don't want the food to go up that way. We don't want nasal regurgitation. And we certainly don't want the food going down through the glottis into the larynx and trachea, because that would cause choking, asphyxiation and aspiration. We only want the food to go down into the esophagus. So the swallowing centre in the medulla oblongata of the brainstem, once it's received these impulses from the 9th and 10th cranial nerves, It facilitates the swallowing process, the autonomic pharyngeal phase. Now, what happens in this stage is several things. You're going to have to stop breathing because you don't want to suck the food down into the trachea. That would be disastrous. So we need to stop breathing. And just to be safe, the vocal cords are going to close off as well. So we're not breathing and we don't want to talk. And by the way, the most common cause of choking is trying to swallow and talk at the same time. So don't do that. Allow your autonomic nervous system free rein to do that which it is very good at doing, in this case, controlling swallowing. So the food goes back into the oropharynx. Now, what happens is you stop breathing, the vocal cords close. Now, to stop the food going back up into the nasal cavities, what happens here is the soft palate and the uvula, that dangly bit at the back of your mouth, they move from that position up to that position, like that. And when the soft palate is flicked up there, then that is going to stop the food going up from the oropharynx, regurgitating into the nasal cavities. So the soft palate flicks up to close off the nasal cavities. That's good. Now, also in this stage, the tongue goes up and back. So the tongue goes up and back. So that means the tongue is blocking off any possibility of the food coming back from the oropharynx back into the oral cavity. So now we have the nasal cavities blocked off, and we also have the oral cavity blocked off. So now the bolus is not able to go back into the nasal cavities, and it's not able to regurgitate back into the mouth. Now the vocal cords are shut, just to be on the safe side, and we've also stopped breathing at this stage for a short period of time. Now the next thing that happens is the larynx, that's the cartilaginous larynx here, this bit. The larynx in swallowing, if you watch your neck when you're swallowing, the larynx actually moves up. So the larynx moves up, and at the same time the epiglottis, that bit, moves down. So if that's the top of your larynx there, the epiglottis, that's the top of your larynx, yeah, that's your glottis, that's the hole into the airway. Your epiglottis flaps down over the top of it like that. So your epiglottis was open and it flaps down over the top, and that closes the glottis, the opening into the larynx, the only precious opening into the airway. So what's happened now is three things. The soft palate has gone up there, closing the nasal cavity. The tongue has gone up there, closing the oral cavity. And also at the same time, the epiglottis flaps down over the glottis, closing the glottis, closing the top of the airway. And as you'll see, this only leaves one way that is left open. The top one's closed, the front one's closed, the lower one's closed. The only way that's left open now is the food to go down into the esophagus. Now, to facilitate this, the walls of the pharynx, remember we've got the nasopharynx, oropharynx, laryngopharynx, the walls of the pharynx are muscular and they will contract and you will get pharyngeal peristalsis, moving the food down, squeezing the food down. So not only is that soft palate stopping it going that way, not only is the tongue stopping it going back into the mouth, not only is the epiglottis flat down to stop it going into the airways, but the peristaltic movement of the muscular walls in the pharynx are propelling the food down the right way into the start of the esophagus here. Now, the esophagus is normally fairly closed off. So what has to happen now is we need to go into the esophageal phase of swallowing. Now, at the top of the esophagus, there's an upper esophageal sphincter, a ring of muscle. But of course, the whole esophagus is a muscular tube. So as the food approaches the top of the esophagus, as the bolus approaches, let's just draw a bolus. Here's the bolus of food now. So it started off here. It was swallowed. It went to here, into the oropharynx, It can't go back up there. It can't go back forward again. It can't go down there. So it has to go down in this direction. And peristaltic activity of the muscular walls of the pharynx propel it down in this direction. And then again, the autonomic nervous system has to control the motor activity of the pharynx and the motor activity of the esophagus. Now, once the sensory impulses get up to the medulla oblongata of the brainstem, there's other cranial nerves take information down to control all this process, all this swallowing process. So again, the ninth cranial nerve is involved with motor impulses coming down, controlling the soft palate, controlling the epiglottis, controlling the peristalsis of the pharynx. The nerves involved there, as we said, there's the ninth cranial nerve that we've mentioned, the glossopharyngeal. There's the 10th cranial nerve, the vagus nerve. And also the 12th cranial nerve, the hypoglossal nerve, is involved in motor coordination of this process. Very complicated process, controlled by the medulla oblongata. And collectively, all these muscles, controlled by the swallowing centre in the medulla oblongata, these are collectively called the bulbar muscles, or the bulbar apparatus. So, for example, if someone can't swallow and the bulbar muscles are paralysed, that would be a bulbar palsy, which, of course, is a very dangerous condition. So all of these bulbar muscles in this area, controlled by the medulla oblongata, impulses going up in sensory fibres of cranial nerves. As a result of that, very clever processing going on in the medulla oblongata, motor impulses coming down, controlling the bulbar activity and controlling the swallowing. So there's the contraction of the pharynx, and at the same time, the top of the esophagus has to dilate and relax. So we need dilatation of the upper esophageal sphincter. That allows the food to go down into the esophagus proper. And then the food goes down the esophagus, propelled by waves of peristaltic contraction. The muscles above, the circular muscles contracting, the circular muscles below relaxing, the longitudinal muscles dilating the esophagus below, and the food goes down, the bolus goes down as a result of this wave of peristaltic contraction in the esophagus. Now, I don't recommend trying this, but you can actually see some people doing it. If you want to stand on your head, you can probably still drink, or drink a pint of beer, or whatever you want, standing on your head. It's not a good idea, but it would actually work, because this process is not just gravity, this process is active peristaltic contraction. Then that goes all the way down the esophagus, which of course goes down through the thoracic cavity, through the diaphragm, and then the cardiac sphincter, the lower esophageal sphincter, has to relax, and that lets the bolus of food through into the fundus and then into the body of the stomach. So the first stage is oral, which is voluntary. The second stage is pharyngeal, controlled by these cranial nerves from the medulla oblongata. It's autonomic. So the first stage, oral. Second stage, pharyngeal. Third stage, esophageal. Also a completely autonomic, involuntary process with a wave of peristalsis. Now, it's very important for anyone involved in healthcare to understand the nature of swallowing. Because if food goes down the wrong way, as we say, the wrong way, into the airway, that's going to cause choking. Now, that could completely block the airway. If there's a big bolus of food gets trapped in the esophagus, maybe a hard-boiled sweet, for example, that completely blocks the esophagus, that completely blocks the trachea, blocks the airway, then of course the patient can't tell you about it. They're not going to come and say, excuse me, staff nurse, excuse me, doctor, I've got a blocked trachea. Of course they can't, because no air can go through it to get to the vocal cord. So all they're going to do is, they won't be able to speak. They'll just probably just gesticulate and point to their throat if you get a complete obstruction. If there's a partial obstruction, you can get some air going in and out. So you have to learn your first aid manoeuvres to treat choking, get whatever's in the trachea out. Another big risk is patients vomit. Now, if patients vomit, especially if they've got a low level of consciousness, the vomit's going to come up the esophagus into the mouth. But then if the patient's unconscious and they take a breath in, then the vomit can get inhaled down into the trachea and down into the lungs. That's called aspiration. And that's going to cause a condition called aspiration pneumonia, which is a very, very serious life-threatening condition. This happens with drug overdoses, for example, when people drink a lot of alcohol or take drugs. They become unconscious, they vomit, and when they breathe in, the vomit goes down into their lungs. So it's very important that we know about keeping the patency of the airway open. So we need to know about choking. And then some of our patients are going to have neurological diseases. For example, after stroke, it might become difficult to swallow. Or patients with motor neuron disease might find it difficult to swallow. And difficulty in swallowing is called dysphagia. Phagia is to eat, so dysphagia is difficulty in swallowing. So the problem with dysphagic patients is that they might not be able to swallow properly, but there's the risk of aspiration, as drinks and saliva or food could be aspirated down into the airways. Now, when someone vomits, there's a vomiting centre also in the medulla oblongata. And this whole thing happens in reverse. So the stomach will contract, the lower esophageal sphincter will dilate, there'll be anti or reverse peristalsis in the esophagus. The peristalsis will be going the other way. The contractions of the pharynx will be going the other way, propelling the food out. And that's important if we've eaten food which contains toxins or something like that, for example. So, lots of applications of swallowing, if you think about it. We need the patients to be able to swallow. We don't want things to go down the wrong way into the trachea. And so we're going to need to manage our patients accordingly. So remember, the oral phase, the pharyngeal phase, the esophageal phase. The esophageal phase, the swallowing only takes about 1 to 4 seconds, actually. If you drink water, that'll go down your esophagus in about a second. And food boluses normally take 4 to 8 seconds to go down via the peristaltic waves in the esophagus into the stomach, facilitating the end result of the process that we're looking for, food going from the outside world to the mouth, down into the stomach for digestive processes.